Hello everyone, are you able to hear me clearly? Great, great. Hi, so good morning to some and good evening to some. All right, so all right. So, do you have any questions before we start? All right, so there are two questions. One is from Sanjay. How can MR jobs process unstructured file like videos or semi-structured file like XML? So we will discuss it today that how can you process something else other than the text document. The other question is from Shravana. Can we get an example on using external jar in MapReduce? Okay, so right now I don't have one where your code is depending on an external library, but we can you know build something. All right, so let me try to see if we can come up with something in which we are using an external library, maybe emailing something or maybe accessing the database. All right. So we'll come up. Let me try to come up with something. And all right. So there's another question. In HDFS, do the data nodes also communicate among themselves due to any reason? And can data node transfer data and output to other nodes? Yes. So the replication happens because of communicating between the data nodes. So when the replication of a block is happening, it is always happening between the data nodes. So, okay, so this was a question from Sanjay. So answer is yes. And do the data nodes communicate? And yes. But we don't have, as a developer of Hadoop, we don't have control over, we don't have a control over how do they communicate amongst each other. All right. Good, good. Now let me try to complete Shravna's question. All right. Okay, so the question is, we know metadata about blocks are stored. Is there anything that is stored in data node. About the next block. We know metadata about blocks are stored. Is there anything that is stored in the data node about the next block? No. So the data node doesn't know about other blocks of the file. Data node only knows about the current blocks and their IDs. Alright, so yeah, we know metadata about blocks is stored in name node. Yes, that's correct. Is there anything that is stored in data node about next block? No, it isn't. Alright. Good. Let's start with the discussion where we left. So everybody clear about Java map reducers, how to create them? All right. All right, this is a good question. Let me address that as well before we start. So the question from Vidya is, I have been modifying stub mapper and stub reducer, which are called from stub driver, could not get when to use stub test. So a stub test is used to test your map reduce logic without having to upload it to the server. Even if you do not have a Hadoop installation, you can run a stub test to test your data, test your logic of mapper and reducer. All right. So you can simply run a stub test after updating the input and expectation, input data and expected output, and your test will tell you that whether what happened after running the mapper or reducer. Have a look at the stub test. You will get an idea. So what I have done in the stub test is that I have put some input. I have also put my expectation and then compared the two and then tested whether our mapper is returning anything or not. So we keep running a stub test while we are modifying our mapper or reducer logic. Okay, so we do not have to every time, for every little change, we do not have to upload our mapper and reducer to the to Hadoop and test. Yes, that's correct, Vidya. Yes. So there is a pseudo implementation of the way Hadoop behaves, okay, which basically runs mapper, whatever is the result of mapper, goes to reducer, and before going to reducer, it gets sorted. So that kind of implementation, a pseudo implementation, is there in the MR unit. We call it MR unit, and that's what stub test is using. Clear to everyone? Great. All right. Let me start the discussion. If you have any question, please feel free to ask. All right. Okay. So we were here last time. Let me just go back to one of the questions which we have left in past. Right. You remember this question? Did anybody try to solve this particular problem? Anyone? All right. So Shravan has, I think, committed to the GitHub. Let me have a look. Lakshman has also done it. Let me have a look at it. All right. So, yep. All right. So let me try to explain to you my approach, okay? And then see if you can get along with that. So based on the content from the very large text archive, formulate the next word recommendation. So what we have to do is, given a very huge file, if you are given a very huge file, how would you use this huge text to generate the recommendation? Let's say you are told that this is the normal data from the chat logs. Okay. English, if this is an English text, say some 100 terabyte of data is given to you. Now, based on this, you have to form what are the words that frequently come after a particular word, or what are the words that come together generally, right? So how could you use MapReducer to generate such a recommendation? All you have to do is, which are the words that are frequently coming together, and what are those five important words that come frequently after a particular word? Okay, so all you have to decide upon is what is it that you have to keep the key and the value in your mapper, so that all the words following a particular word would come together, and then you can do the statistics. Right? So, all right. So Vidya's approach is to keep the key as the word and the value as the next word. Good, brilliant. Now let's have a look at what are the downside of such an approach. Okay, so what exactly is Vidya suggesting is this. Okay, you have so for a, let's say you're given a big corpus of text, a lot of text is given to you. And out of this, you have to prepare the recommendation. So all you did was, for each pair of words, you made the key and the value. Okay? So for how, R is the word that is following. For R, U is the word that is following. So we make how as the key, so that all the words that follow how become together, because this data is going to be sorted and grouped by MapReduce, right? So all the words that follow how are going to be together, and they will get grouped together. Similarly, all the words following R will group together, and so on, right? Do you see any problem with this approach? Brilliant. This is good approach, Vidya. But there are some minor problems with this approach. Is this what you are trying to say, Vidya? Thank you, Karthik. Karthik says the word Ram happy does not make sense. Why? Because the sentence has ended at Ram, and happy doesn't really come after Ram. Okay? So, yes. So you have to avoid such kind of words. Second problem, do you see that? Same on the same lines. You and Ram were supposed to come together, but they did not. Right? Reason being, we were given by MapReduce, we were given the input line by line, not the sentence by sentence. Right? So you might argue at this point that since it's a 100 terabyte corpus of data, so such corner cases can be ignored. That's correct. And that's where the big data comes into play. So such if you have big enough data, such corner cases can be easily ignored, right? Yeah. So that's exactly the argument from Vidya, is that such corner cases will be rare and thus will be ignored. Okay. So, but a lot of time, because if you think about number of lines, so if each line has say 5 words, so at every 5 words, we are making 2 mistakes, right? First, for each, we might be grouping wrong words together because the sentence has ended already. Second is that every 5-6 words, if there is a new line, so we are not grouping 2 words together. So our mistake is around 1 out of 5, which is 25% mistake. And that is sometimes not tolerable. Okay. So yeah, first is, if you think about it, the word like R will have so many words following them, right? Word like R, word like 2, they will have so many words that come after them, right? So what would happen in such case is that all such words will be going to your reduce function in a single shot. And therefore, your reducer will overflow from memory. Right, it will overflow the memory of the reducer. That is one problem, and therefore the computation of frequency, and also if you think about it, even if it doesn't overflow the memory of the reducer, finding the frequency of top 5 words that follow R is going to be very resource intensive. It is going to be actually a word count, right? Why couldn't we utilize MapReduce for this kind of word count, right? So therefore, you might have to twist a little bit such that the key, you will form the key by concatenating first word and second word, such, and then computing their frequency. All right, let me explain again. So there is a confusion about this. So tell me, in a corpus of say 1 terabyte data, how many words would be there that follow R? Many, right? R would actually exist in say 1 in 10 sentences. Okay, so if there are 1 million sentences, then there will be 200,000 such sentences that contain R or is. So these kind of common words like the, of, is, am, are, all of such common words will have too many words following them, and therefore it will bother your reducers, because for each of these words, all the words that follow will go together to reducer. Right? You remember our discussion where I was telling you the values for a key, all of those values will be fed to the reducer running on a single node. So those values will not spread across multiple reducers for a particular key. Therefore, they will overflow the reducer, and hence this computation can be solved in a little bit different manner. So what you could do is, you could take 2 words and form the key out of them, then take another 2 words, form the key, and do the word count on that. So let's take this, okay? So for this, you could actually form the key by, say, how dash r, and the value is 1. Similarly, r dash u, and the value is 1. Now, after that, you can do various computations. Okay? So, I leave that to you. You can think about the various solutions and come up with the one which does not overflow the reducer. Correct. Thank you, Vidya. You are exactly right. So, you are exactly with me. So, this is what Vidya has written. Brilliant. Good. So, this is how you will solve. All right, so you can basically computation of frequency can be either further map reduced or you could change the approach a tiny bit. All right, now second is last word, and these two problems are something which we need to discuss. What we want is we do not want our text file to be processed just like that. We need to process it by sentence by sentence. And sometimes you want to process it in some other fashion. All right, so Sanjay's question is, how are we going to ignore the words like R of the ETC? We are not going to ignore such words. Instead, we are going to use MapReduce's ability to handle such kind of things. Okay, so in essence, what I'm trying to say is, if there are too many keys, Hadoop does not bother. But if there are too many values for a single key, your reducers will get overloaded. Okay? But if there are millions or billions of keys, it doesn't matter, because it's going to be distributed, it's going to be handled by many mappers, and therefore it is not a problem. But if there are too many values for a key, then it's a problem for a reducer. Therefore, such kind of strategies where we are shifting load from a reducer to multiple mappers is a good idea. Right? So instead of forming a key by the word like is of the, we are forming the word by using first word and second word concatenation. Do I make sense to you? All right. So this is one problem which we are going to discuss now. So here, in case our problem is that we do not want to concatenate these two, as well as we want to concatenate these two, as in consider them as key value pairs, or we consider such case as well. Why? Because in case of our usual plain text kind of ways, we are not able to process our input data sentence by sentence. We are processing our input data in line by line fashion. Okay, so that's one problem. Second problem which we left you with last time is this. So again, let me give a recap. These are not same examples first, so do not get confused. Okay, these are different examples. All right, maybe I'll update it. I will just leave a comment here. Okay. These are two separate examples. Good. So let's discuss the main problem which we had left you with. First was that, so as we have all studied so far, that the file is broken by HDFS into blocks, and based on the blocks, the data is read by various mappers per block, and then they process it. Now, if you think about even our word count, let's imagine this. Let's imagine this, that your text file contains 11 lines. These are really, really big lines, okay? These are really, really big lines for the sake of this discussion. Now imagine that first 5 lines, okay? So 4 and some part of 5 is in first block, and some part of 5 and rest of it up to here is in the second block and third block. Okay, now what do you see here? You see that while our mapper is being processed, mapper will be processing this block of data, this block will be cutting at the boundary, right? So on each mapper, the data will not be complete. The boundary will be something in between the line, in between the word, or in between the sentence, correct? And therefore, when mapper runs, it has to run on a complete line. It doesn't run on a small part of the line. Otherwise, your results will be absurd. All the results will be absurd because it will show you the words which have been cut into two as two separate words. Okay? So you have got a block. The last block is broken. There are high chances the last block will get... last line will might get broken like this, and so on. Now you can see that here, while mapper gets run, so there is something called input split. So when a mapper runs and it tries to read the data, it tries to create something called input split. An input split is made up of records, right? It's like loading the data, parsing it, and forming records. And bunch of records are called input split. Okay. So on top of the block, an input split is created. And when the input split is created, there this section of data, which is on second node, see, the sum part of fifth is on the second node, that get transferred to the first node. This slight transfer of the data happens just while forming the input split. Similarly, for the input split 2, the data from the block, which is the line number 9, is going into third block, that get transmitted here, and so on. So now you can see that the input splits are very similar to blocks. These are blocks. One block, two block, three block, and these are splits. So input splits are being formed on top of blocks, and input splits contain the data in which we want it. All right. So some of the discussion we had last time, that why don't we store blocks just like in the form of complete lines. The reason is we do not know how we are going to process the data which is given to us at the time of writing into HDFS. So HDFS does not know what will happen to the data, what is inside a file. It doesn't care, it doesn't know whether the file is binary or whether the file is text. HDFS doesn't know and doesn't care. It has no differentiating behavior between video files, audio files, text file, or anything else. For HDFS, all of these files are same. What matters to HDFS is that what is their file size, how many blocks should it create, and how should it distribute it. So irrespective of how great your file is, it is going to cut it at the block size and then spread it across. Okay, so that is the behavior of HDFS, because you do not know in how many ways you are going to process the data. Today, let's say for you have a good file called in plain text one. Right now, you want to process it line by line, but tomorrow you might want to process it sentence by sentence, as in our case of recommendations example, right? So it doesn't know in what manner you want to tomorrow parse it. And for each of these methodologies, you might be creating different kind of input splits. Okay? All right? Good. So Hadoop divides input into pieces called input splits, as in MapReduce divides it. The MapReduce, which it runs, divides the input display input into pieces called, I mean, divides, or you can say loads the data from HDFS into pieces called splits. Okay, so based on the blocks, input splits are generally created. Generally, there is a one-to-one relationship between input splits and blocks, but it's not necessary. Let's imagine that you are doing an MP3 analysis, right? And your file is 200 MB containing say two blocks. Okay, so your file contains two blocks, and all you want to do is you want to compute the checksum of the file. You want to compute the checksum of this file, which is of 200 MB. For checksum, you need the whole file in a single shot, right? You need to, if for checksum, you have to go through the file and then load the data from the whole file and then compute the checksum. Checksum could be, very simple checksum could be, you just sum up the letters, the ASCII codes of the full file and then divide it by some number, right? So that way, there could be multiple ways of computing checksum. Checksum is like signature, the signature that cannot be fuzzed or cannot be predictably altered in modifying the files. Okay, you cannot predictably alter the checksum. Okay, so and for that, so if you're using there are standard checksum computing algorithms such as MD5, SHA-1, all of these algorithms need the whole file in a single shot, right? So there could be multiple ways in which you are accessing file. Therefore, input splits is part of the MapReduce, not HDFS. Okay. So the data which is in the blocks gets loaded into splits. There are many different libraries which provide different kind of input splits, and so isplit contains multiple records. A record could be line, a record could be multiple key value pairs. So the way you have in database, a row is equivalent of the record. So that's how you can look at it. All right. Now, when somebody is designing their own input split, and if they are creating very small input splits, the overhead could be higher, right? Imagine that here our input split was only two records at a time, right? So let's say we want to have two records at a time only. Now what would happen is like 1 and 2, so there will be one input split, other input split, and so on. Now since we are telling you that there will be one mapper instance per input split, therefore there might be lot of data transfer starting to happen between the nodes that contain data and the nodes that contain the input split. Right, like you can see that every time we create an input split, the data gets transferred from block 2 to block 1 and block 3 to block 2 and so on. Therefore, a split may contain many records, and if you try to do small splits, the overhead could be really, really high, because we are also creating one mapper on each input split. So if you have very small input split, there could be many mappers running on your input data. So generally what people have realized is that good split size tends to be equal to HDFS block. And it's no brainer. You can see that the more you have one-on-one relationship. So let's say this is machine 1, machine 2, machine 3. Containing the blocks, right? So machine 1, the data is stored here as block, gets loaded on the same machine and gets it, mapper gets executed here itself. And similarly, machine 2 having the data gets loaded onto the same machines, running input is put on the same machine, and so on. Right? This way, when you have if you have your input spread very close to the HDFS block, it becomes very easy to have it becomes very less overhead. All right. Now I'll go through the questions quickly and see. Let me increase the font size and save this before notes session 7, 29th August. All right. So here's a question from Vidya. Is the first part of 5 stored near the second part of 5? No, it's not. Okay. Second part is stored somewhere in the network. Okay. It's not necessary. So the second slice might be stored nearby, or due to other reasons, it might be far away, in case the nearby nodes are not having the space. So there could be many situations. All right. That's correct, Karthik. Yes. Good one. Record in our context is one line of text. That's correct. All right. Okay. So what is the difference between HDFS data blocking? So HDFS data blocks are created by HDFS, while input splits are created by MapReduce. All right. Now, Lloyd's question is there any tuning required for input split? Is this a parameter? Yes. Okay. You must have seen in your MapReduce example, the viewer setting something called set input split. And that was input split, and that we were setting to the text. We will show you that. How mappers on the second block will ignore the text from current block that was considered? Yes. So, all right, this is a very interesting question. So, this is something done as part of. So, imagine that. So, okay, I'm just thinking, should we consider now? Let me just try to explain this strategy. Okay, let me take this example itself. Okay. Can I paste here? All right. All right. So yeah, let me just take a question from Lakshman. All right. So yes. Or okay. Let me park it, and there are actually many other questions, and those all are related to the same thing. Okay. All right. So in this example where we are talking about, so there's Sanjay's question. Sanjay's question is, 5 will be carried to the next block. It is carried from the next block to the first block where the first block was stored. Okay. So is there a default input split? Yes. And we are using text input split. All right. Let's go into more details. All right. So most of other questions which are there right now are, I am hoping that they'll get answered very quickly. And in case that get answered, let me know. Otherwise, we'll go into the details again. All right. So records are clear to us. Input split is clear. Input split is basically records. And a record is the definition governed by our needs, whether we want line by line or whether we want something else. Now, the real thing. So by default, Hadoop provides you many libraries. And there are many, many more libraries that have come up in the open source world. For every kind of processing, there is an input split available to you. I mean, in the form of input format. Okay, so to create input split, we use input formats. And basically, input format creates input split. Input splits contain the records. And record is what get fed to the map function one at a time. One record at a time is what is fed to your mapper function. So the input format governs everything. So let me here text input format. Okay. This is what we were using. So in your Java, in the Eclipse, you must have noticed that there is a line where we say that our input format is text input format, right? Sarvana? So you could see that in our class, we had discussed this. All right. Coming back to... Good. So you could see here that we can, while defining the job here, we have defined the entry point name, which is step driver, mapper name, and the reducer, and then the data type of the output, output keys, and output value, and number of reducers, then the data type of output of mapper, output key and output value of mapper. Now here it has by default assumed the input format. You could also force your own input format. Okay, so you could say input format is text input format dot class. This is what is happening by default. Okay, you don't have to mention that explicitly. All right. If you want to process, so here we have an example where we are showing you that how to process n lines in a single mapper. If we have to enforce this, we can use some other input format called n lines input format. This is our class. We have written it here. Okay. And the example is available in the project also. All right, so there are many, many input formats today available, starting with text input format. And also, we were saying that each input is split. For each input is split, mapper will be created. We can control that in case of another input format called n-line input format. Okay, so... So if you're using, and also I forgot to mention this part in case of text input format, in case you want to split your records instead of line, say, let's say you want to split the data sentence by sentence. So you could use dot as the delimiter. Okay. By default, the delimiter is slash n. Because based on the slash n, it splits the records and it basically processes record by record by splitting the data like this. So you could choose your other delimiter by using this. Okay. You could say something like either text input format dot set part filter, or you could say job dot set you can say config dot set, and then you can provide the key values. Okay, and you could say that okay, my delimiter is dot. Okay, so this is how you could do this. So our first problem is solved. Instead of splitting our new line, we can start splitting by dot or dot space. Okay, dot space. All right, but things get more and more complex when language comes into play, because dot might occur in the number as well as dot may occur inside the double quotes. So it is far more complex than possible. So we rely upon our rudimentary technique and big data to give us approximately correct results. All right. So that is one thing. Now there is another text input format called n lines input format. If you want to split n line, you want to make sure that each input split should contain exactly n number of lines, then you can use n lines input format. In case you want to use fixed length input format. Have you used ever a file in fixed file format? Have you ever used? Let's say there is a data in which it is guaranteed that the each line's length is going to be equal. Okay, each line is the way the data format is that. Inside a line, the fields are of fixed size, as well as record length is very clear. In those cases, you could use fixed line format. Okay. So this fixed line input format is responsible for creating input splits based on the various lengths. So you could say here, you could use fixed lines method called set record length and provide the conf method to it and say, let's say you are using fixed line input format. Let's see if it gives, create a class, change it to fixed line input format in MapReduce. Okay, we'll use the newer library, we'll not use the MapRed one. Okay, here we could say fixed length, and we could say set record length. Okay, so if our record length is 100 and that's how our records are divided, then we could simply say something like this. And then we can start parsing our record and performing whatever we want, because each record will be given to your map function. Make sense? So first you have to split the whole data into records, and how that splitting is going to happen is governed by input format. Here, our each record, one record and other record are separated by their lengths. Okay, the way we are parsing the data is based on the lengths, and in those cases you use fixed length input format. You could also, of course, create your input splits, your own kind of input split, but that will be very rare. Okay. All right. Now here, there's another kind of input format, which is key value text input format. If you are dealing with if your file, instead of containing normal text like we had in case of word count, in case you have data in the form of, if you have data in the form of key value, then you could use the key value input format. Okay. All right. So basically, files are broken into lines by each record is separated from another record based on new line, and each record is further broken into key value, and key value separator by default is equals. You can change it by modifying this particular property. Okay. All right. So, is anyone's question left from earlier? I know I have not answered, but has it got answered by itself? If not, please paste it again. Let me try to answer your questions. Yes, go ahead, Ravikant. All right. Now this, okay, so this question, yes, is the one pending. Good. So there is one question which, yes, I agree, is pending from Lakshmanan. And yes, let me try to explain this while we will design our own custom input split. Okay, when we design our custom input format, we will discuss that. All right. Now, if your data exists in key value pairs, you can use a key value text format. While key can be plain text and value can be binary data, value can be anything. All right. Now, there is an interesting kind of an input format called sequence file input format. Okay, so what exactly is sequence file input format? Sequence file input format is basically an input format which contains the definition in the header, and rest of the data is in the whole body. Just like if you have ever heard about the email format, where we define the header and then there is a full detail of the data. So basically, people realize that most of the files, whether it's a video, it's a JPEG, or it's a zip file, or it's a audio file, in all of these kind of formats, what happens is you define a header. Okay, you define a header, and the whole file is kind of a binary file. Okay, so keeping that in mind, the people created something called sequence file input format in order to basically tackle a general class of problems. Okay, and the right away uses of sequence file input format is to handle zip file, jar file, tar file, and the very large archives. Okay, so basically, when you have very small files, let us say that the smaller images of all the people on Facebook, okay, their profiles, smaller images have to be stored somewhere, right? Each small icon of every individual hardly takes 1 KB or 10 KB, okay? It might be taking a space of 10 KB on the disk. Now, if you try to store a 10 KB file or 100 MB file, they both take equal amount of space on the name node, right? So whether it's a small, so which effectively means that small size file in huge number can overflow the name node. And to avoid that, what people did was they combined such small images into a single, they basically zipped all of them into a single file and then stored into HDFS. Now, if you try to store such files into somewhere, what would happen is every time you want to process them, you will have to read them and you will have to form the single file and then unzip it, right? If you have a zip file, normal zip file, right? Have you ever used a zip file which has five parts? Did you? So whenever you had to process it, whenever you have to do anything with this zip file, you have to first combine all the parts and then unzip. So that was a big problem of the zip file. So in those cases, what people did was they started creating, they formed something called splittable zip. So such kind of splittable zips are very useful in the sense that while you are forming your input split, you do not require to join all the parts. You can basically form your input split on the sections of this zip file, and then you don't have to combine all the parts of the zip file in order to process sections of this file. Okay, so it's like having a big folder, putting all these small files into the small folder and then processing them. Okay, I'm not sure if I was able to explain. Let me give it another shot. So if you have a million of 10 KB file, right, which means it will be 10 gigabyte data. Now 10 gigabyte data or let me take a simple example. So you have 1,000 icons, right? 1,000 icons, which mean icon images of each 10 KB, which means 10 MB, right? And for 10 MB or one icon is the same space that's going to take on name node, right? So to avoid name node overflowing, what you do is you generally create a zip file containing all these images. Now, if you create a normal zip file, it will be a big hassle to unzip it. So people founded something called gzip splittable. Okay, it's a format in which you zip a file, and it creates a splittable zip file. Okay, so that each individual parts of this zip file can be processed easily without requiring all other parts. Okay, that is gzip splittable. Now, gzip splittable is basically another just sequence file input format. Okay, so there are many such formats which are in this format called sequence file. It basically, a sequence file is, it's a flat file in which there is a binary data as key and the binary data as values. Okay, so each file has got details in the headers based on which the data is passed. Okay, so header tells you that what is the format of the data inside the file, and accordingly sequence file input format processes the file and creates the individual input split. Okay, did it make sense to you? Everyone? So sequence file input format is a very good one. And whenever you encounter the binary formats, sequence file input format is something you can have a look at it. All right. So basically, if you use a normal split file, it will be difficult. So you generally convert them into gzip splittable and then load it using sequence file input format. Okay, so basically it's a nice sequence file input format is a nice input format in which the binary data is generally stored. Okay, so see, you basically for lots of data you basically use sequence file way and store your data in that format so that you can process your data in parts even if it's binary. Because the impression which we have carried always is, if you have got binary data, it has to be combined first and then processed. In case of big file or big data, if you have big data, big file in the binary format, okay, the usual ways will not suffice, and therefore you generally rely upon techniques like sequence file input format. So Lakshman's question is, can we use sequence file input format for small files like XML? Yes. Okay. So in those cases, so if you have, can, okay. So each record will be a single XML file. Make sense to you? So if you have if you have bunch of hundred million images, okay, you could create in bunches, like you could create the zip splittable files and then process those using the sequence input format. And you will have each record as individual image. Okay, so you can process a single image on a mapper individually. All right, now there are a few more notes. First, we have already talked about ggip splittable. There are few more ways called LJADO. LJADO is a compression techniques which have been designed better than ggip format so that you could archive data and still split it. Okay, it's a format in which you do not require too many blocks of data in order to unzip. Okay, so individual data can be compressed together. Now Sanjay's question is, the splittable file should be less than the block size? Not really. Okay, splittable file, even if of 1 gigabyte data, say 100 gigabyte of data, they will have multiple blocks. Okay, and you can load them as sequence file, and in case of in this, each individual file will come as a, each individual file will be given to you as a single record. Okay, so that handling of whether a particular file is on is divided or not, all of that complexity is handled by sequence input format. Okay. So Lakshman's question is, so we need to have an idea about how are we going to use the data. Not much, actually, not much, not much. So there, the thumb rule is, if there are, okay, if the files are going to be too small, use either GGP splittable or use Eljado to combine the file and compress those. Okay, that way you are able to properly store them, as well as you are consuming less space, and you know that MapReduce, if people want to run MapReduce, they'll be able to run it and then process it. Okay. If the files are big enough, okay, then you don't need to worry. Okay. Although if the files are small, you can store happily on HDFS. It doesn't deny. Just that after few million files, HDFS's name node might require more RAM, and you will have to upscale the name node. That is the only problem. Makes sense, Sanjay and Lakshman? All right. Everyone, Anandita, is it clear, a little more clearer now? Great. All right. So sometimes you have to have your own input split formats, right? In case, let's say you realize that what problem you're trying to solve, it's not yet, there is no input format yet. But I would strongly recommend that, to basically do a bit of research and then start building your own input split format. Okay. So like, I give you a good example. So I was working with one of my friends, and who works at National Labs. So they basically were processing a lot of geo-information data, okay, where they take the photograph from the satellite and they store those data into certain format. And now they were storing them in their traditional network file system, the way we designed a rudimentary file system, distributed one, in the beginning of the class. So they were having a similar kind of model where they were basically putting the data into multiple machines manually. Now, when I was thinking about their problem, that okay, what they need is they need to find out, let's say, the various layers using multiple machines, and this is how they are going to do it. So I was trying to think about the creating a new custom input format, given their kind of problem they were trying to solve, right? Because they needed to do image processing, they needed to bring the data per coordinate, as per the coordinates on the image, they needed to bring it across from multiple maps. So I was trying to form a input format so that the data can be, the input splits could be created location wise, actual physical location wise rather than input file format, input file data. So I was trying to create my own input format, and that time I thought, okay, let me just try to give it a Google search. Okay, I searched for the exact same data format on Google, and I found that there is this brilliant open source project by, I think, Carnegie Mellon, who was doing exactly what I was trying to build, and I could instantaneously use it and could help them immediately. So before you start building the custom input format, you do a basic search, and you will find that the data, there is already a input format available. Okay, I'll give you an example. So one telecom company from Saudi Arabia, they were discussing few problems with me, and their data, their equipment data was in XML format. Okay, so there was this huge mammoth XML file which contains the information about so many equipments. Okay, now the idea was to this XML file will be of say 10 gigabytes. Okay, this XML file contains a lot of information about so let me just write it down. So a single XML file was around 20 gigabyte and contains information about many equipments, right? So if you visualize, this 20 gigabytes would be having so many blocks, right? It'll be having around say 200 so 1 gigabyte contains around 10 blocks, so 200 blocks, right? Now the XML file is splitted, and we wanted to process the information of each equipment easily using MapReduce, and I was thinking, like, how should I break this XML how should I load it such that each independent node from the XML get loaded on the individual input split. Should be basically the loading the data should not require loading the whole 20 gigabyte file. At that point of time, so we were thinking, like, how should we form our custom input split? And then I gave it a search, and then I realized that, okay, there is a project from Mahot guys, and they had created an XML input format which basically splits the data of XML and loads one node at a time on individual mapper. Okay, node, I mean, here I'm talking about XML node, because XML is a tree structure, has very many sub nodes. So they were able to load individual XML node on individual mapper. Okay, so there are many such examples I could give you where most of my problems were already solved by somebody else. Okay, so there is a question from Ravikant. The question is, regarding the last question, we have already stored the data in HDFS. It is just the way we are reading from it. That's correct. Okay, because if we try to read the whole 20 gigabyte and we try to read it and then process it, then our whole objective of we won't be able to process it and transfer it. Because it takes a lot of time to transfer 20 gigabyte data over the network, first. Second, it will be difficult for a single node to process 20 gigabyte data. The better thing is, the way 20 gigabyte data is splitted onto 200 blocks, we basically try to process each individual blocks by making some sense out of that data and then making it work on the individual node. Okay, so that's the whole magic about input split format. Make sense to you, Ravikant? All right. So I hope everybody is with me. Everybody is following. And good. All right. So if you have to write your own input format, you could create a class that extends input split base class. Okay, let's have a look at it, what we have done. We are trying to create here our own input format. So we have given it a name, okay, and it's extending some input format called text input format. Now, if you go into this, you'll further see there is a base class here, text input format, which is basically extending the input file format, file input format. Okay, if you keep on going into it, you will realize that at the end of it, they basically all extend input split class. Okay, so every input split, every input format, sorry, this is the one which you are talking, every input format is basically, their role is to, at the end of day, their role is to provide splits, okay? Given a particular job context, provide me the various splits. And what does a split mean? A split means what is the length of the input split and where is this particular data existing on the HDFS, okay? So each input split is basically the locations on HDFS. All right, and when we read input split, then we will try to basically find the actual location and read the data from there. All right, so the objective of any input format, whether it's a text input format, XML input format, or any other, the objective is to be able to give you the splits. Okay, so Hadoop internally calls splits, and then based on each input split, it calls your mapper and run mapper against the input split. All right. Now the second method of your class, if you are creating an input format tomorrow, the most important method is the create record reader. And this create record reader basically forms the record. The duty of create record reader is to give you one record at a time. Okay, given an input split and the context, it gives you the record reader. Okay, so when you are creating the input split, you first create you extend the input format. Right now I'm extending the subclass of input format, but you could also extend input format, okay, directly. All right, now you can see here that we are providing, when Hadoop will ask input format, can you give me a record, it will give Hadoop the record reader and tell that you can get the records from this record reader. And this record reader, what it does, it basically converts a split into, it converts a input split into a record. Okay. Okay. So here you can see that record reader is giving out the key, okay, based on the data provided to it and the value, okay. And how is it doing is something little complex. I will talk about it. I'll try to explain using a diagram right now. All right, let's have a look at it. So let's have a look at it here. Let's say there was one block. This is one block. This is one block from here to here, second block and third block, okay? The lower boundary we are talking about. And for each of these blocks, there will be the instance of your record reader created. One instance here, one instance here, second here, and third here. All right. So imagine this. So when Hadoop starts processing your data, the first thing it does is it starts to create input splits and the records. Okay. And to do that, it uses the record reader. And this is how it uses. So on all the nodes where Hadoop has figured out that your data is stored, when you ask Hadoop that, can you please do the word count, and here is my input split reader, here is my input format, then Hadoop first thing it does is it finds out all the blocks of your file in the network. It found all the blocks of the file in the network and asked all those machines that contains that blocks of file to execute input format. Okay, the input format is somebody who is responsible for creating the input split. Input split means the records, so-called the records we have to prepare. Now imagine this. So on parallelly on all the machines, what's going on, the task has been assigned to individual nodes to convert the blocks into the records. Okay, so and this logic is being run parallelly on all the nodes. So the way, let me just be very specific. So it'll be, the pointer is just pointing to the beginning. So the logic which has been coded on all of these, that as soon as you encounter a new line, okay, create a record. All right. In case you have not encountered the new line, say let's talk about this guy. So it will keep on skipping the first information till it reaches here. Only then the second guy, all of these have been coded such that they have all been told, if you are starting from the beginning of the file, then you can create the record. Otherwise, keep on skipping data. So this guy, the second guy, will keep on skipping data unless it hits the border. So all of the data from here is going to be transferred to the first block. Similarly for him, the logic that has been coded into create record reader is, keep on skipping data unless you hit the boundary. Okay. So the logic in all of these, text input reader, the text record reader, is that keep on skipping the data unless you hit new line. Okay. So skipping data means giving the data to the previous node. Now, this rule is not something valid for our first block. Reason being that in case it skips data till here, then who will process this record? Therefore, there is another condition while reading the record, is that either you are starting from 0th byte, or if you are not starting from 0th byte, keep skipping the data till you reach new line. Okay, and that's how it identifies, that's how it creates, it transmits, it realizes that the data has to be transferred. Or in case, let's say you are working on an XML document and your node definition is slash my equipment. Okay, this is, okay, so you are processing the data about lot of equipments. My equipment ID equals 1, and you have another equipment whose ID equals 2. Okay, so in such cases, what will happen is that your record reader will keep on skipping the data, your record reader will keep on skipping the record unless it hits this one. Okay, and as soon as it hits this one, that means now it is 100% sure that it's the beginning of the fresh record. Okay, then it will start giving this data to the newer input split, their own record. Otherwise, it'll keep on skipping to and will keep on giving it to the previous record. Okay, does it make sense? Now, this is an interesting question. All right. Yes, this is an interesting question from Lakshman. Lakshman says, so until the input splits of all the blocks are complete, none of the map function can be called. Can anybody answer this? Can anybody answer this question? It's an interesting question. So his question again, let me rephrase it. So as it looks like a complex process going on here, unless all of these three arrows finish their work, finish up to here, it looks like that none of the input splits will be ready and therefore map reduce process will not start. But if you remember correctly, our map function runs on a single record at a time. Right, therefore, as soon as this guy has finished the first record, the first line will start getting fed to your map function, and first map function will start parallelly, and then second and then third. So on first record, all these lines start getting processed as these things are happening. It will wait at the last line, you know, here, until the second one has conveyed that I am done giving data to you, I am starting to consume the records now. Okay, so from here to here, this section of data, you'll keep on throwing it to the previous guy, and then once it is done with throwing, it informs the previous guy, hey, I am done throwing the data, I have figured out the border, and now I'm going to give the records to my own input split. And meaning, on the same note, there'll be a mapper running and will start consuming the sixth line as soon as it's ready, and then seventh line, and then eighth line, then ninth line. That's what it's going to. So as in when your input format is producing output, is getting fed to the mapper. Make sense to you? Correct. So Ravikant says mapper functions can still start. Good. All right, brilliant. Any questions at this moment? So basically the mechanics is to figure out the boundary, and if you are processing a data in which figuring out the boundary is difficult, then handling that data is little difficult. For example, figuring out the boundary in case of JSON document is tough. Okay, so a JSON document, if you guys have been following, looks like this. Okay, x equal to 10 and y equal to 30. Okay, so this is JSON format. Let's say I have coordinates, and inside coordinates I have another object like this. Okay, so this is another way of data representation. This is called JSON, right? And there is another, I mean, when we say XML, we will say coordinates, and we'll have starting coordinates and ending coordinates, right? So here we know the ending very clearly, that our coordinates have ended if we encountered something of this sort. Therefore, figuring out the border is easier, right? If you think about this arrow, he will keep on going from here to here, and the moment it finds the border, it will realize that now the time has come to consume rather than throw. Okay, throw means giving it to the previous guy. So here, if you start from here to here, if you are not able to identify the border, then it's very difficult to form the records. And that's what happens in when you try to process JSON record in HDFS. If you have a huge JSON file, and you are trying to process that using MapReduce, it might become a little difficult, because it'll be difficult because we don't know whether it's the bracket belongs to the internal coordinates or the outer coordinates, right? Otherwise we'll have to, you know, keep loading the data from left to right, keep parsing it and trying to understand. This actually a complex process. So it's not that straightforward when you talk about JSON. All right. So is it, I think your question is answered now. This one and this one, right? These two questions. All right, so is everyone with me? All right, for your convenience, I have written, I have provided a couple of examples. Those who are interested in going deep into understanding how to form the custom input format, they can have a look at this good example, which basically tells the same approach what I've just stated, okay? In it's a little far more in detail. You can have a look at it, right? So generally the idea is to figure out how to create records and then do this, all right? So most likely you would not have to create the input format, but what you would require is an understanding of which record reader to use in what circumstances. Okay, so that is a very important aspect. All right. All right, and any questions now? All right, let's take a quick break. So a 10 minutes break and back by 10:17 p.m. IST. Okay. Hi, I'm back. So should we start? Hi, is my voice audible to you? Are you able to hear me? Great. So should we start now and our All right, let's have a quick look at what we did earlier with respect to the mapper and reducer. And let me make the screen a little bigger. Good. All right. So, okay. Now does it make sense to you that so there are multiple input splits, not HDFS blocks, that are given to the mapper. Okay, so input splits are giving record by record to the map function. For each record, the map function is being executed. And so this is mapper instance. Mapper instance is being created per input split. And for each record, the map function is being called. Okay, now the output of map function is being sorted and then being carried to the single reducer where the sorted records are getting merged by using merge sort techniques. And once that is done, the merged for after merging, the grouping would happen, and for key and all the values, the reduce will be executed. Okay, and the data gets saved into HDFS. Makes sense to you? Now, moving ahead. So this was how a single reducer worked. Now, second was the multiple reducer. This is something which we want to discuss now. Okay, so if you remember, we talked about something called buckets. So in case you have multiple reducers, the division happens just after map function. So map function gives key and the value. Now here itself, the division starts happening. So it creates two buckets, one for reducer one and other for another reducer. And this separation is done just after mapper. Now you might ask, what is the basis for this separation? Okay. So is everyone with me till here? I think we are back to the zero where we started. Okay. And so here, what's happening is mapper's output is being stored in two buckets. One bucket for one reducer, second bucket for second reducer. All right. So this way, some of the keys are going to the first reducer, some of the keys are going to second reducer, and that's happening from all of these map nodes. So from all map nodes, there are high chances that there are going to be communication to all the reduced nodes. So if you have m number of mappers and r number of reducers, total number of transfer that is going to happen is m into r. For each mapper, the data goes to reducer, which means to R. And if there are M mappers, total number of transfer is going to be M into R. Yep. So here you see those two dashed arrows. On what basis does this separation happen? Just give me a second. Hi. Sorry. Actually, it was just a balloon burst. I thought something happened. All right. Yeah. So, all right. So this separation is done on what basis? Okay. By default, it is done based on the hash code of the key. Hash code is a number, a numeric representation of the string. As there are many techniques to generate the number out of the big string. And it's a number, basically. You can say sum up all the values of the character and create this number. So it's just a hash code. There could be multiple strings for the same hash code. Now, this could be based on the hash code, okay, or this could be with any other technique. So if you have a better techniques of dividing the data into multiple reducer, then you can use that technique, okay? If you think that your way of dividing the data into reducer will make your reducers more performant, okay, then you can customize this division by having something called partition. Okay, so basically by defining partitioner, and the way you define a partitioner is you extend a partitioner class, all right, and then you define the key value data types, and then you implement a method called getPartition. And what does getPartition do? It basically gives out a number. It returns a number saying that whether this particular key should go to first reducer, second reducer, or third reducer node. Okay, which node should a particular key go to? That is the duty of the partitioner. So partitioner basically returns a number indicating the reducer, okay? And number starts from 0, not 1, okay? So if you have 3 reducers, the value that is returned by get partition could be 0, could be 1, could be 2, all right? So let's say that I want to make sure that first set of records, which are first reducer, should only receive the records where the gender is male. Okay. Second reducer should receive the gender where the gender is not male. Okay. So we can do the partition this way. All right. Now, let me again try to demonstrate to you what I mean by partition. All right. So do you remember our example where the word count was happening and there were two parts? So let me again try to say, this is an apple and this is an orange. Okay. So here, the way, if you have two reducer one and reducer two, there will be two output files for each reducer, right? So this equals to two, or let me say n is two, apple is one, and is 2, and then this, and maybe, so n goes here. I'm just trying to do random stuff. There is no predictability in this, okay? All right, so you can see that individually the records will be ordered, okay, but But if you concatenate reducer one's output with another, the data is not sorted, right? If you try to say concatenate this, it's something like this will happen, right? So how to make sure, if you have to solve this problem, that let's have reducer one and reducer two the data which is mutually exclusive. Okay, for example, you want to say things like all the words, all the keys up to J should go to reducer one, and all the keys and rest should go to reducer two. Then what would happen is we would be able to easily concatenate the two files, and the result will be nice. Result will be ordered. Okay, if we make sure that from A to J go to the first reducer, which means first file, first output file, and from J to onwards up to Z should go to the second reducer. So you can just concatenate the two files and the result will be there. This is where the partitioner comes into play. Okay, have a look at here one of the partitioners I have created. So download this other project in this session number 4 or 5, where you can see all of the details. All right, so here we have. All right, so here I'm saying that if the key is from 0 to K, less than K, which means up to J, send it to the first reducer. And how am I telling that? By returning 0 here. Okay, otherwise return 1. This is what I'm saying here. So you can, when you're creating partitioner, you can just copy this definition and modify this piece of code to return the various values of various numbers to indicate which reducer a particular key needs to be sent. So if the key which is being for each key, your partitioner method will be consulted. Your partitioner will be consulted for each key. And whatever partitioner says that, okay, send it to that particular reducer, that particular, but it will be sent to that particular node. Okay, does it make sense to you? All right, another question from Sanjay. In a cluster, do we exclusively set number of reducers? Yes, we do. Okay. All right. So here is another question from Sharvana, that in this case there would not be the load balancing between the reducer. Very good point. So here, if you see what we are saying, that send all the words that are starting with A to J or up to J to the first node, and otherwise send it to the second node. Now here what's happening is there are chances that all of your data is concentrated up to A to J, up to J, and first reducer might get a lot of data while second reducer is fairly free. Yes, that is fair, very much possible. That's a very good point, Sarvana. That's very much possible. But sometimes your business need are such that you have to do the partitioner. Or sometimes you realize that the usual way of partitioning data is not good enough. The hash code way is not good enough by Hadoop. Therefore, you require a better tool. And that's where you define the better strategy by defining a partitioner. All right. Is everybody clear with respect to partitioner? All right. So how many reducers, although we have discussed it already, by default, we have one reducer. If you have too many reducers, the shuffling will be too high. If you have too many reducers, a lot of shuffling will happen. This, you see the transfer here, there are six in numbers. If you have 10 reducers, then 10 into 3 will be 30 transfers, or shuffling will be 30 times 30. And if you have too few reducers, these nodes will get loaded. And so you have to tune it to basically you have to figure out how many computations can happen over your cluster parallelly, and between one and that value you have to basically fine tune so that your data is basically distributed to multiple reducers rather than overloading as much reducer as possible. I mean, rather than overloading one or two reducers, it should overload multiple reducers. Okay. So good. We have already discussed how to compute the total number of slots. You basically find out slots, as in on each machine, generally the default number of slots are two. So you sum up all slots available in all nodes, and that is the total number of slots. All right. Yes. Sanjay's question is, are the reducers also replicated? Yes. Okay. Meaning, in case one reducer fails, there is another reducer. There is another node that is made reducer, and the data is shifted to there. Okay. So they are all resilient. Okay. Good. All right. There is another interesting idea, another interesting concept called combiner. Okay, when we did character count, if you remember our character count problem, if we were making the key, each character as the key, what was happening is the data from mappers to reducers will be huge. Okay, because each character is a key and one is a value, and therefore there'll be too much of data that gets transferred. But if we could summarize the data before sending it to the reducer, it could have been great. If we could summarize the data, if we could run some kind of processing on each node, each mapper node, so that only small data gets transferred to the reducer. Okay, and that's where the combiner comes into play. Okay, so combiner's role is to combine the data from multiple map functions, single mapper node. But as the data is coming in, combiner is combining that, summarizing it. And then once the combiner finishes the data keeps on getting transferred. Data goes to the partitioner, and partitioner transfers it to the reducer node. Okay, partitioner transfers it to the reducer node, and that's where the, after shuffling, the reducer starts. All right, now here you can have a, so does it make sense to you? Here what we are doing is the key value pairs being generated by map function is being combined by combiner and then giving to the partitioner and then going to the reducer node. That is the role of combiner. So combiner basically runs on the same node as map. Okay, processes the output of map function, helps in minimizing the data transfer, and does not replace the reducer. Reason being, combiner is only minifying the data on a single node. Combiner is running on single node, while reducer is gathering the data from multiple nodes. If the same key is existing on any other node, reducer will get it, but a combiner will not get the keys from other nodes. Okay, so that is combiner function. Now there is an interesting concept that comes with the combiner. All right, now Sanjay's question is, combiner and sorting are the same on the same node? Yes, combiners and sorting are happening on the same node. After partitioning, the sorting will start happening. Okay, Savna's question is, why the partitioner? It cannot be directly sent to the reducer. So partitioner, there is a default partitioner. This partitioner's duty is by default deciding which data goes to which reducer. If there is only one reducer, there will be no role of a partitioner, because the data has to be sent to the single node. Okay, so but if you have multiple reducer, who will decide which key goes where? That's where the role of a partitioner comes into. Yes, thank you Vidya for that definition. Vidya says that combiner is a local reducer. Yes. Anandita is saying, so combiner and partitioner are doing the work of Hadoop. So they are all part of the work of Hadoop. Okay, so combiner basically is combining, or you can say summarizing the data, minifying it before it gets transmitted to the reducer. All right, sounds good to you. Now there is a catch. There is a catch, and that is very important. So although every function, every reducer function's definition could be used as combiner, okay? The definition, there is no other class from which you have to inherit the combiner. You can use any reducer what you have defined as combiner, okay? Now there is a catch. Not all reducers can be a valid combiner, okay? So okay, Vidya's question is, before combiner there shouldn't be a sort. Sorting is happening after partitioning, okay? All right. Suresh's question is, I think the reducer combines the sorted data from mappers. Okay, so what is the need of a combiner? So the combiner's role is, before transmitting data over the network, if you want to minify it, if you want to minimize the transfer by doing some sort of operation, okay, local reduce on a single node, okay, to reduce the amount of transfer or do some other purpose, if your logic requires all the data on each mapper node to be summarized, then you can use combiner. All right. Yes, that's correct, Anuj. So, yeah, I don't know which Hadoop grouping are you talking about, but it does the job of reducer. All right. All right. So, now here is the catch. Here is the catch with respect to combiner. And so a combiner does not get called on all the values in once, but it is called on the values as and when they keep on coming. All right? So a combiner is called on few values at a time, and then the result of the combiner is again passed to the next. Okay, let's talk about the summation problem. Let's say in the combiner, what you're trying to do is sum up the values. Okay, the way it's going to do the summation is, all right. All right, let me try to explain how does combiner work. Okay, let's say for a particular key there are 10 values. 1, 2, 2, and 4, and 5. Okay, and let's say 19. All right, so there are these values of the for a particular key. All right. And what you want to do in the combiner before the data get transmitted to the reducer, you want to sum up all these values. So how will combiner work? Combiner will not simply take all the values. Okay. It will not take all the values in a single shot and then sum it up. Unlike our reducer. In our reducers, we got all the values in a single shot. In case of combiner, whatever you logic you write, it will be called recursively. Okay, recursively as in, say, first it might get called on these three values, and you get a result of 2 plus 2 plus 1, which is 2 plus 2 plus 1 is 5. Okay, and at the later point of time, the same combiner logic might get called again on these values. Okay, and then you will have what? 5 plus 5 plus 4, which is 10. Okay, you will get 10. Next is that you can basically, after that, again, same logic will be called on these two values, okay? And you will get 29. Now you see that in case of, so the arrow, basically, the arrow is what is, so 1, 1, 2, 3. Okay, let me just make it a little better. Make it a little more logical. Okay, so first our combiner was called on these values, then these values, and then these values, and so on. So unlike our reducer, where there is only one call of your reduce function for a key, here combiner is called multiple number of times. Why is it so? So that if you have so many values for keys, you can still combine them together. All right? And this way basically the combiner is able to reduce the data such that it's not overloaded. But this kind of recursive thing is not good for all kinds of problem. Think about computing average. You cannot compute average in this manner. Here, summation of some of the values with the summation of some other value, the total of totals is equal to the total of all the numbers, right? But average of all the numbers is not equal to average of parts of these numbers. So average cannot be a great combiner function while the summation count minimum is all good. So this arrow represents how many times the combiner has been called. Here you can see the combiner is called 3 times. All right. So Lakshman's question is it called? So are you saying who calls the combiner? Yeah, you guys are right. Here it is supposed to be 14. And then you see, thank you very much for letting me know. All right, and this will be all right. So Lakshman's question is that is number of times combiner is called is equal to number of records? No. Okay, it is called for few values and there is no predictable way. All right, so good. Lots of you have pinpointed that this, I have made a mistake. Good, that means you all are listening and at least seeing the screen. I'm happy about it. All right. So, okay, so is the idea of a combiner clear to all of you? This is a very important concept. And the idea of a combiner is basically recursively computing the values. Okay, so if we had to compute minimum, okay, this was what? This was computing the summation. Okay, this was summation. Okay, let me just save it. All right, if we have to compute the minimum, let's see if the same strategy could have worked. So minimum of all of these numbers is how much? 1, right? Okay, so let's see, the minimum of 1, 2, 2 is 1, right? And minimum of these numbers is again 1. And then minimum of these two is 1. So effectively, minimum is a good function that could be used as combiner. All right. Now, if we have to do the maximum, okay, maximum, what would happen? Here is 2. Here it's 5, and here it's 19. You can see that? Does it make sense to you? So maximum of subparts is maximum of overall. Okay? So all those problems that can be divided and conquered can be done. For those, you can write combiners. If you can do compute the in parts and then use those parts to compute the total, then it that can be a good function for compiler. Okay? Sounds good to you? Next is let's try to compute average. So can anybody quickly tell overall average, what is the average of these numbers? If you have a calculator at the desk. 33 divided by 3 plus 3, which is 11 by 2, and which is I think 5.5. All right. So a very good question, a timely question. I'll answer Tushar's also before I get into the average. So combiner can be said as local reducer for summation process. Yes, and also reduce the network congestion. Yes, that's a good point. Yes, that's correct, Tushar. Vidya's question is combiner starts only after mapper has finished. So it doesn't wait for the whole mapper to finish, but it starts doing the computation as and when data arises. That's why so first mapper might get called when there were only three records it noticed for one key, and then it so first combiner can be will be called as and when possible. Okay, so the calling the combiner process is it keeps on happening all the time. It doesn't wait for mapper to give out all these values. It starts with whatever values it gets. Make sense? All right, let's try to see if we can compute the average. Can somebody open a calculator and help me? What is this? How much is this? Yes. All right. 2 plus 2 plus 1 divided by 3 is 5 by 3, right? So let's put it 1.67. Thank you, Anandita. Sir, I'll get answer your question. All right. Okay, now what is the summation? This one. So what's the average of 4 and 4 plus 5 plus 1.67? Around 3 point what? 5.5. Okay, now the average of these two values. Eleven point 28. Okay. Thank you. I'm actually following your answers. I'm not doing the computation. Good. So you can see that it came out to be 11.3, which is absurd, right? So average is not a right function for combiner. If you do the computation, total computation, okay, so it's like 10 and 3, and so it's 33. 33 divided by 6 is around 5.5, right? So you can clearly see that if we did the average computation of all the numbers together, Let me try to do it using. If we do the computation of all these numbers together, then we get an average of this one, right? But if we do the way we did combiner, our results are 11.3. Don't you find it strange? So, which effectively means that there are only few functions which can be used as combiner. All right? Which can be used as combiner. So generally, the thumb rule of using something as combiner is they have to have this property of where if you operate on parts of some array, and then the result, if you combine again, should give you the right answer. Okay. So you can basically run any problem through this kind of an example quickly and check if the answers are correct, then you would be comfortable at making it combiner. Okay, so do not make functions like average a combiner because they will lead to the wrong answers. All right, I missed your question, Sravana. Okay, so could you just repeat because I forgot the context. Sanjay's question is, for average, the combiner needs to combine all key value pairs. Will that not overload the reducer? So can we avoid that? So did you get the answer? So it will not, right now we will not be able to use combiner for average this way. Instead, what we'll do is we'll do a little clever thing. What we'll do is we'll compute the summation. If we have to compute the average, we will compute the summation, we will compute the counts, and in the end, we will compute the average after the reducer has finished. Okay? So, Savna's question is, why can it not happen after all mapper is done? Okay, so the idea is to utilize the parallel computing. While mapper is doing the work, can we parallelly start minifying the data? That is the reason. Or start executing combiner parallelly. So that's the idea of running combiner as and when data is arriving. All right. All right. I think I hope I'm able to answer. Okay. Good. Good. So is this clear to everyone? Let me now ask you a few more questions. All right. Yeah. So the same thing has been depicted here. All right. Now the question to you is, there is a good function like this. Okay, what does this function do? It basically is a combiner which takes all the values and returns the square root of, you can think of this function as that it's getting these values and it's returning the square root of sum of the squares. Okay, so if it's getting whatever values it's getting, it's basically summing up the squares of those values. Do you think function f is a great combiner? Anyone? Is it a good combiner? Can we use this function as combiner? Lloyd says, okay, let me not disclose that. Why do you think that? if you call this function just like the way we demonstrated here earlier, will it lead to the same result? Okay, let's try to see that. Okay. All right, let's try to draw it. I have A, then I have B, then I have C, then I have D. In real life, it'll be a number. Okay, so let's try to do this. So let's say our combiner is getting called on these two first. Okay, so what we will get, anybody? Square root of A into A plus B into B. Let's say okay, so once that is done, let's call it something like Z. Okay, now again our combiner is called on these two values. What would it result lead to? Anyone? Okay, Z square root of Z square plus C square, right? And which is, you can see, square root of A square plus A square plus B square plus C square. Do you see that? So Z square is equal to A square plus B square, and that's what I've written. All right. So Z square is equal to A square plus B square. Let's again call it, say, T. Now, if you do the same thing again over these two set of values, these two set of values, okay? So, if I say T equals this, and then I'm going to run on this, these two, okay? What will happen now is something of this sort. Okay, so you can see that at the end you will again get square root of T square plus D square, and therefore it's a square root of T A square plus B square plus C square plus D square. Okay, which is equal to, if you call the same function on all of these in a single shot, if you had to call on all of these in a single shot. Yes. Shravana, you are missing square root. Z is equal to square root of A square plus B square. All right. So I was just trying to demonstrate this kind of property. You will find out the kind of combiner. I got into the details because it's very much required in almost every distributed computing framework, be it Spark or be it some other framework. you will find this kind of functions everywhere. Okay, because what is happening here, even in the sorting, if you remember merge sorting, we sort the data in parts and then sort the sorted data. Okay, combine the two multiple records and sort it. Similarly, whenever you see a big data, you break it down into small parts and combine it and then do the results. So combiner is this kind of functions which are called, they are called symmetric and reflexive, I think. I'm forgetting their name, mathematical names. But my objective here is not the nomenclature. My objective here is to make you able to see through that what kind of functions could be used in divide and conquer. All right? Great. Let's move. So does it make sense to you, all of the combiner functions? Good that you all worked with me to solve this. And I hope that would have helped you understand it. All right, let's move on. All right, so this is something which Sarvana called and asked about today also. And this is something you must have faced if you try to solve a voting problem, okay? So the idea of giving the voting problem is you should basically face this kind of challenges so that we can you can grab the idea of chaining. Now, the job chaining's purpose is to basically combine multiple jobs back to back. So let's say you have two jobs, job one and job two. The output of mapper, let's say that after word count, let's say you wanted to sort the data by their frequencies. Okay, you want to find out, you want to basically order the words based on their frequency. Okay, so there you will require a second MapReduce job which will sort the data. And here you can basically see it clearly that it's very straightforward when you're using your Java code. Let me show you from the in the editor itself. So if you see our stub driver here, this is the place where we wait for the job to complete. It actually launches the job as well as it makes you wait. All right. So the most easiest way to chain the jobs is by putting a kind of if condition that if this one is successful, then execute this one. Then execute this one. Okay. The second method could have been by chaining the command line. If you are a little aware about what does it mean by ampersand in case of Unix, okay, then you will be able to understand this. It's essentially saying when my first command finishes, it's a part of Unix. So it basically says that when my first command finishes, execute the second command. All right. When the first command finishes, execute the second command. Third method could have been that you use OOSI. We will consider that in chapter number, session number 9 or maybe 10. Okay. So there is a tool called OOSI which helps you create beautiful workflows. If you are impatient, then you can actually have a look at Hue and try to use OOSI there. Or you could use something like dependencies. Dependencies is a good idea, and you can basically download this particular project and import it. There I have given a full example of creating dependencies. So you could basically create two jobs, job 1 and job 2, and mark job 1 as depending on job 2. Okay, so sorry, job 2 is okay, so job 2 and job 1, we are creating a graph here. Okay, and when you use this particular approach, when you have say 10 jobs and you do not want to compute the order by yourself, you want to leave it to Hadoop to execute the whichever job it likes to do first, okay, based on the dependency graph. So if you define this dependency, then Hadoop will, as in this library, will identify which job to execute first and which job to execute last. Okay, so you could use dependencies in order to execute the jobs back to back. All right, so you can import this particular project. Okay, and all right, you can have a look at say this particular code. So here what we have done is we have defined normal job, so job 1 and we job 2, and then we have defined something called control job over the config, and control job is basically a wrapper over your usual job. So we have created two wrappers, C job 2 and control job 1, and then we have added them to the job control. Okay, here, and after that we have started them. The only thing you can see here that we have defined a dependency in the control job. Okay, and based on this, automatically it will order which one to execute first and which one to execute last. All right, again let me rephrase what I just said. So there are many ways. One is using your own Java code. Second is using the command line. Both of these are, this and this are almost similar. Third is using dependencies. This is almost similar to our first approach. Just the difference is, if you have complex dependency graph, it will be easier to use this one. It will automatically figure out their order in which these jobs need to be executed. We call it topological sorting. Okay, so it'll figure out which one to execute first and which one to execute last. And the last one is OOSI. In larger projects, you essentially use OOSI instead of any of this. Reason being, OOSI this will execute on your local node. Okay, this logic of running dependencies is going to get executed on local node, while Uzi will make sure that it runs on any node in the network, and in case any of the job fails, it will try to execute it on another node and will try to run it. Okay, so this, if you see, let's say there was a this program is running on one particular node, the node on which you have executed this command, right? From where this logic is being run. In case that node get killed, then it won't be able to launch the second job. Although, if the job one is launched, it will keep running in the on the Hadoop. If this machine on which this condition is running, in case that dies, still job one will complete, but job two will not launch. But if you are using things like Uzi, they will make sure that it happens. Yes. So Lakshman's question is, can Uzi be used to chain mappers? No. So there is no such thing called chaining mappers directly. It's always chaining jobs, and a job consists of mapper and optionally a reducer. All right. Now there is something called pipes. It has been deprecated now, and it's not, I mean, not too much used. But if you want to use C and C++ for MapReduce, you can use pipes. Okay. Oh, I think pipes is better than streaming, but I need to check if it has been deprecated. But I have not seen many people using pipes. Okay. So if you see, when you run Hadoop command, you will see one of the options and suggestions called pipes. Pipes is basically for running C, C++ code, and you can run your program in this following manner. All right. So, okay. So there is a question from Savna. Using dependencies, are bin local or are local or HDFS? So these dependencies are actually mostly resolved locally. Okay, so Lakshman is saying that there is something called chain mapper and chain reducer. Let me have a look. So chain mapper, as I understand so far, is they are basically a wrapper over the mapper. Okay, these are basically a wrapper over the mapper. Okay, so that they can be used inside the job conf. Okay, and yeah, it looks like the chain mapper makes it possible to use multiple mappers as a single map task. Good, thank you, Lakshman. Yeah, looks like it can chain the mappers, as in, effectively, it will be a single piece of code which will run on a single mapper on the machine. Okay. All right. It's mostly on the library basis, but inside Hadoop, when we schedule a job, the way it happens is that no matter what logic you write inside a mapper, if you are trying to chain two pieces of mappers together, they will be basically executing like a single mapper. All right. So Sarvana's question is, if node fails, what will happen in case of dependencies? So let's say the node fails. Let me just go back to the example. Let's say we started job one here and we are waiting for job one to complete. The machine from where we launched this command, okay, that gets shut down. So job one will complete, but job two will not get executed. In case you are waiting for completion on job two, in that time, the machine from which you launched this piece of code using Hadoop jar, in case that gets killed or something happened with that machine, then job two and job one will successfully complete. There won't be any impact. All right, does it make sense to you? All right, Lakshman, are you with me? All right, great. All right, now moving ahead. Okay, so there is one particular feature that has come in Hadoop, and it's part of execution. So the overall idea in case of execution is to make the execution more and more resilient and fast. So there are many strategies which Hadoop takes care of. So one of them is to do the speculative execution, as in start executing even if it's not required. Let's say there are task tracker 1, 2, 3, 4, and it notices that the task 4 is not finishing while everyone else has finished. Okay, so the task 1 finished, task 2 finished, task 3 finished, task 4 is still pending, meaning task 4 tracker 4 is busy doing things while tracker 1, tracker 2, tracker 3 have finished successfully. Now Hadoop thinks that there is something wrong with the task tracker number 4, and in order to mitigate the risk, it launches a copy of the same task on one of these nodes which finish the work fastest. Keeping in mind the data locality. Okay, keeping in mind the data locality, it parallelly executes work to somebody. Okay, it's like giving same project to two teams in your office, thinking that the other team is not finishing the work. Let this fresh team start, maybe they will finish faster than the older team. Okay, and that's what is happening. It's a duplication of work, but in order to get the results faster. So you can see that the task tracker might finish the task number 4 earlier, and whichever finishes earlier, if this one finished it earlier, then that will be it. Okay, that will be it. Okay, so it could be either one. So this is called speculative execution by Hadoop. Hadoop does a lot of speculative execution, and it's optional. You can turn it off. All right. Now this we have already been talking about data locality optimization, and this is quite important. And so in a data center, you have basically in your organization you might be having multiple data centers. Inside each of these data centers, you might be having multiple racks. Racks are kind of almirahs where you put your nodes, you put your computers, and each rack also has got a switch inbuilt. Switch as in the kind of a router, a small hub to which all the computers connect. So these mostly, this concept of a rack is quite old. It has been going on for quite some time, and the each rack comes with inbuilt kind of LAN cable port, and all these computers who are connected to the LAN cable in these racks are in a local network. Now, these racks, there are hundreds of such racks. So the computers which are sitting in the same rack, they can talk to each other faster. If two programs sitting on the same computer can talk to each other really, really fast, while the computer sitting on the two different racks will be able to talk to each other slower than the computers which are sitting on both. So the dream of everyone is to have the data at the program on the same node. The scenario number A. The second, the worst scenario than the A is B, where program and the data, okay, as in HDFS block and your map task, the program and the data, they are sitting on the same rack but different node. And the nightmare of anybody is that their HDFS block is on one machine and it's getting transferred to some other rack, completely other rack, and so that it can be processed. And the worst is when you have two data centers and data is getting transferred from one data center to another data center in order to get processed. That is slowest. Okay, because these data centers might be in different geographies. All right, so this is quite obvious. So basically, we are saying that these A, B, and C, in these three cases, best is A and the worst is C. All right, and Hadoop prefers to do A to B and prefers B to C. All right, and this is what is known as data locality optimization. Now, anybody answer these questions? Can reducer take the benefit of data locality optimization? Anyone? Correct. It cannot take, because the input to reducer will be from all the mapper nodes. Okay. All right. Now, this is a little tricky question. If you have to say Hadoop FS minus copy from local, and then you copy the file, where all will it store these copies of the file? There will be three copies of each file. Where will it store those three files? Anybody? Same rack, same node, different nodes. How will it store? Although we have discussed it already, but still. So Lakshman says different racks. Lloyd says rack 1, server 1, rack 1, server 2. So Lloyd is saying two nodes on the same rack and th- third one off the rack. Yeah. All right. Tushar says first replica on one node in rack A, other in rack B. Okay. Good, good. Almost all of you are correct. And also, this strategy has been changing for quite some time, and they keep on making improvements to it. So right now, this is the approach. First one will be on the same node on which you executed this command. Hadoop FS copy from local. If you are logged in on Hadoop 1.nobigdata, then it will first put the data into the data node which is running on the same machine. Okay, because it doesn't have to do much. It just have to move the blocks from here to there. That's it. And in some cases, it doesn't have to even create the block. It will just rename the file and move the file into that folder. And moving the file is easier than copying the file, right? So the first copy will be on the same node on which the Hadoop FS was called, and second will be in the same rack. If you are on the rack number one, the second block will be on the same rack. Third one will be off the rack. All right. Now, the way we look at the network topology is in the form of tree structure. You basically create a tree structure, and the best way to represent a tree structure is in the folder structure way, as in server1/rack1/node1. And that's how Hadoop understands the network topology. So you can see that you have got two racks, one switch, meaning one data center, and each rack contains three machines each. All right, and this is how it's represented. All right, and so basically, there is if you go into yarn site.xml, you will find one particular key called topology.script.filename. And this is the script that controls how to create the topology. Okay, the job of this script will be to give out this kind of a folder name for each of the node. Okay, for each of the node, this kind of file name or folder name will be provided by this particular script. By default, it basically creates the folder names or folder structure based on the IP address like this. Okay, that's the default behavior, but you can configure it using this topology script file. You can customize it so that you can clearly say that node 1 means this in the tree, node 2 means this in the tree, and the way the distance is computed is how much steps will it take to reach from one node to another. Like if you have to go from node 1 to node 3, it'll be 1 and 2, right? If you have to go from node 1 to node 4, it'll be 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, in computer science, the way you compute this distance is find the common ancestor and find the distances of the two nodes from the common ancestor and sum it up. So common ancestor from node 1 and node 3 is rack 1. Okay, and the distance of node 1 from rack 1 is 1, node 3 from rack 1 is 1, and you sum it up. Similarly, the common ancestor, the lowest common ancestor for node 4 and node 2 is switch, and the distance of node 2 to switch is 2, node 4 to switch 1 is 2, and sum of 2 plus 2 is 4. Okay, so that is how you compute Hadoop computes the distance between two nodes and accordingly figures out who is closer to the data and who is farther to the data. And accordingly, it figures out from executing map logic on which block will be fastest and which block will be, of which node it will be slowest. Okay, so that's about the rack awareness, and the same thing I have explained in these distances. So Lakshman is saying, does it not consider pipe capacity? Not much, not much. Unlike other systems like MongoDB, Cassandra, where they ping one node to another and accordingly figure out the closeness of the node, it doesn't do that. Okay. It basically it's a hardwired way of you defining that this is our structure. And moreover, the pipe capacity doesn't matter too much in the same data center. It's the same LAN cable, and it happens that way. But in case of one data center to another, that pipe capacity does matter. All right. So you can see that the distance between these nodes, so you can do a computation, and you can see that distance between D1 R1 N1 and D1 R1 N1 is zero. Okay, and D1 R1 N1 and D1 R1 N2, meaning node 1 and node 2 on the same rack, the distance is 2, and distance between N3 and node 1 is 4. Okay, on the different racks. And if they are in two different data centers, the distance is far more. Okay? Does it make sense to you, everyone? All right. That's pretty much for today. We'll catch up tomorrow, and we'll go through the data locality quickly tomorrow again. And have a great day. Your assignments, which you have done on GitHub, let me review them. And those reviews will take a bit of time, maybe a week. Okay, so as soon as you are done, just let me know, okay, the way you have been doing, because I do not know whether you have finished or have not finished, okay, or you want to give it another try. All right, thank you very much. Have a good day. Bye bye. So, all right. So Divya's question is, should we redo the subjective question assignment? It is up to you. If you think you can do it better, you please do it. It'll be great. All right. Savna's question is, where can we get good MapReduce examples? So, okay. All right. Let me try to do that. Okay. Let me try to figure it out, because I haven't got any great MapReduce examples so far, other than what we have already. Okay. But definitely look at the matrix multiplication example. Has anybody looked into the matrix multiplication example, which I asked earlier? So, ouch, where did it go? Something wrong. All right, have a look at the matrix multiplication example. All right. Bye-bye. Thank you, Sarvana. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day ahead. Thank you, Vidya.